everybody. Just waiting for a few folks to come on. Welcome to Boost Power Tech TV Podcast. Let me just check the connection, a couple things, and we'll get going here just in a second. Open this door. All right, so I'm Alexi Sahagian at Boost Power Marine, and I wanted to do a part two on the compound supercharging tech. We talked about my boat and some of the projects that we were working on, and we weren't planning on doing a part two, but we did get a lot of questions. So we wanted to address them from the emails and then give you guys a chance to ask questions about compound supercharging in general, along with any other tech questions related to high performance for the next half hour to 45 minutes. And we can go longer if we need to, but that's the plan. Obviously there's different time zones, so people will be logging in and out, and then they usually watch it again later, which is great. So we appreciate that feedback. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to attempt to show you on one of our classroom boards here that we use for our EFI school. And I want to show you guys some of the things that we went over, but maybe more dig into it a little more with the technical side of things. Some of you will understand it right away, and some folks will just get confused. But I'm going to try to break it down in a way to where most people can understand the technology, how it works, why it works, and a couple different ways to think about how compound supercharging works in general. And again, it's all from the information we've gathered over the years to boost up our product line and some of the information that we gather from the dyno and testing and real live events. So I'm gonna start out by flipping the screen here and going over some basic things before I address the questions from some of the folks that wrote in, so it's not kind of redundant. So I'm gonna go ahead and flip the camera. So what I got here is I got our little chalkboard set up. You can see that we got a couple different, you know, scratch pad notes or whatever you wanna call it here. And you know, this is the typical illustration of kind of how this system works. But what a lot of folks are confused about is really what, you know, the big question is, do you need to compound supercharger? I mean, we get a lot of that. The answer is no. You don't have to get the net horsepower that you want. In our opinion, two big turbos can do the job. But there is pros and cons to setting up engines in certain ways to make the compound supercharging a choice that you may want to consider. So let's talk about basic supercharger and turbocharger information, okay? I'm holding the camera, so I might not be the best at it here, but I'm going to try to explain it with my nifty little pencil that my daughter gave me. So let's just say this is a power grid, okay? And you have a turbo, which is marked in black, and you have a supercharger, which is marked in blue, okay? And this is your RPM range. It can be zero to whatever it is. Let's just say you have the same engine that's 500 cubic inches. Usually the power curves look like this. You have the turbocharger, which, you know, you floor the engine, and then all of a sudden after it lags and the spooling comes up, the power is abrupt. It comes way up really hard and then kind of tapers off, and you're here and you're making max power, okay? If you have the same engine, you have your supercharger that's more of a smoother curve. Right off idle, you got instant power, and it kind of plateaus in the same place if these are matched, you know, compressor-wise, okay? So that's great. This might be a better driving machine here because it's smoother being supercharged. And this one may be laggy and annoying unless you have a second gear in your boat or some kind of an aerator like a lot of the big offshore boats have. to break loose the propellers to allow this little void right here to act more like the supercharger. Like, for example, if you drive like any of these Skaters, DCBs, MTIs with twin engines, or the new Merc turbo motors even, with all the technology they have, they all still lag. So it's just the nature of the turbocharger realm. If you look here, if you put an aerator set up on your propeller, what happens here is this area is hardly noticeable, because what happens is right as you go to plane, the RPM and load changes by slippage, and it actually, if you look at a log of the pattern in which these engines run, they actually skip through this and transition into the power like that, okay? But if you were to start out in third gear in a V-drive boat or have no way to break the props loose, this would be an annoying thing to drive. You'd be have no power, you'd be wide open, and all of a sudden the power comes in, and that's hard on parts, annoying to drive, definitely horrible at low RPM if you're coming out of a turn and you have big propellers and you try to throttle the boat. I mean, it's hard to drive. Sure, the technology today is better with fuel injection to control that, but still, it makes it rough to drive. So again, a supercharger is more of a kind of a linear deal. It's smoother all the way through, okay? But here's another thing you got to look at. Supercharging, you know, so let's just say the same 500 cubic inch engine in the turbo makes the same power right here, okay? The supercharger has drag on the crankshaft. Of course, there's technical words for it, but let's just keep it easy. It drags through the belt, so it pulls power away from the crankshaft. Plus, the air inlet temperature is usually 30 to 40 degrees higher than any turbo motor, whether it's intercooled or not, because there's two giant rotors going around in a circle with a tight clearance, and that plus compressing air equals temperature. So your air inlet temperature is pretty high. Still pretty good, and it can be managed with an intercooler, and that's not a problem in 90% of the cases. But if you compare the same size turbocharger, it has zero drag on the crank. It has 110 degrees, say, Fahrenheit versus 140, because you have usually two turbos that are sized properly. So they're basically pulling in ambient air and compressing it, but you don't have the big rotor spinning around, okay? So you, and the turbocharger is like putting a vacuum cleaner on your exhaust. So if you have a vacuum cleaner on your exhaust, your engine seems to be more efficient. So at the end of the day on the dyno, when you look at these two with the same setup, usually the turbo motor is making more horsepower with the same size deal, okay? But there is a lag section in here that's really annoying to drive, and in some boats it's very prevalent, or noticeable is the word. You notice it so horribly you get tired of driving it that way. And again, a lot of the small boat guys out there that are watching with a V-drive boat, you can't start out in third gear with most turbo boats. You know, most turbocharged boats, you got to start out in second gear, spool the turbo up, and then go ahead and shift to third before you're going to have enough torque or air movement to keep the turbo spooled up and the power in. On a supercharged motor, you can start in third gear, may not be the best, but you have power immediately all the way through, okay? Now, when you go into compounding, I'm going to attempt to explain it in the easiest way to where you don't have to be a rocket scientist to understand, but it can stimulate questions, so we can go over some of it along with the questions that were written in before. So I'm going to flip again here. Okay, so now that we went over this, I want to go back to my ugly little drawing here, and I want to explain. So we have an engine, okay? And usually this would be the exhaust going into, say, a turbo, blowing into a manifold and then into the engine, okay? Typical twin turbo setup kind of looks like this. Now let's introduce a single supercharger in this case. So let's just say we're able to have a crankshaft spinning the supercharger, okay? And that makes for a regular positive displacement supercharger. So let's just forget we have these turbos right now. Let's focus on supercharger. Okay? People calling me here, but regular supercharged motor works really good here. and the exhaust coming out of the turbocharger spools the turbo, goes into the supercharger, and let's just say that that's how the compound is, okay? Now, in the compound supercharging world, what happens is you're driving a supercharged engine right here. And because you're driving a supercharged engine, the turbocharger side of things, let's just say, is doing nothing. You're designing your supercharger for the engine size, okay? Imagine that you have zero lag, which you do in a supercharged setup, and your limitation to your supercharger is based on pulleys. So in most cases, you have to run a big pulley on the bottom, a small one on the top to create, let's just call it the same 500 cubic inch engine, 10 to 15 pounds of boost. So if you're making 10 to 15 pounds of boost with the belt, you're having to spin the RPM of this supercharger fairly high, which turns into a lot of air inlet temperature and more drag to turn it. The drag pulls power from the crankshaft, okay? When you compound the engine, you design the engine and the pulley setup to where it's either one-to-one or just barely overdriven to where this supercharger is at its maximum efficiency. So let's just say this is an 8.1 liter Whipple supercharger and the maximum efficiency, let's just say, is 8,000 RPM. I'm just using numbers. So you have it pulleyed to where this thing is set up and, you know, you got a big cubic inch engine. So let's just say the supercharger on the dyno with no turbo going to it is making 12 to 14 pounds of boost. That's great. The air inlet temperature is under control. The thing's set up really good. It has power like this blue curve, linear all the way through to where it's nice to drive and very smooth and docks and idles well. Okay, now let's go over and add the compound effect, right? We all talk about exhaust on our cars. You know, it's a huge market. Everybody wants to put headers and mufflers on their car. Well, the reason is you want less back pressure or more flow so you can get more air and fuel into the engine, right? Now imagine on when you put a supercharger on your car and then you change your exhaust, it's such a big difference because you're forcing air in, but it still has the stock exhaust and can't get out. So it makes a big difference, right? And we're breaking this down to where it's simple for some of you folks understand it very well, some don't, so I'm just bear with me here. So back to the engine that's supercharged. Now all of a sudden you're introducing a huge vacuum cleaner right here. Let's just call the headers a vacuum cleaner. So it's literally sucking air out of that engine. So you have, it's like running zoomies on your drag boat, except it's pulling a vacuum. It's actually sucking air out of the engine, okay? That alone makes this engine's ability to get air into it and out of it a lot more efficient, right? Which is basically what we refer to as volumetric efficiency and the ability for it to basically pump air. So now you have a supercharged engine. Let's just say you're running this engine just like this, and you have your turbo header and just a turbo, and just see, pretend for now that the turbo is just blowing into the air. It has nothing to do with the pressure side of this engine. Right now, you already have a benefit. You have a vacuum cleaner on here. As soon as this turbo spools up because of the volume coming out of this engine on the, based on the supercharger, this deal right here is automatically, let's just call it a vacuum muffler, or let's just say it's a vacuum cleaner sucking that. So automatically, your ability to scavenge the air out of the engine has gone up in efficiency, which means that this blower, potentially the boost could be going down, right? As this spools up, this went from 14 maybe down to 13 pounds of boost based on how the cam overlap and all that. That gets technical, but let's just say nothing changes and now you have a vacuum. So you have an exhaust benefit, okay? And let's just say the way this is pulleyed for the ultimate air inlet temperature after the intercooler, say, is 100 degrees here, right? In order to make more power on a supercharger, you got to put a smaller pulley here or a bigger pulley here. Well, we don't want to do that because we know that this blower, the maximum efficiency of this or two of them is X. Once you know that, you leave it. Now you come over here and you introduce a large turbo. Okay, so we're going to put this ugly turbo right here and we're going to point it in and put it on the back side of the throttle body. So we're going to pump air pressure into the supercharger. We call this, let's go back here, we call this vacuum state negative pressure scavenging. This is what's going on here. It's pulling air out of the engine and it's, let's just call it the vacuum cleaner, the scavenger, okay? Now we're doing what's called stage one pressure, which is on both sides. We refer to stage one pressure as the pressure differential between the turbo itself and the ambient air coming in from the atmosphere and the supercharger only, okay? So if you were to run a boost gauge on your dash and have one here versus here, it's going to be two different things. This is the pressure difference between the turbo and the supercharger. Down here is your net supercharger boost after all this stuff is going on, okay? Hopefully you guys are still with me here. So stage one PSI state is this area here, pre-throttle body, before the supercharger compresses the air, okay? What happens now is this supercharger, based on how much volume of air and the pressure differential that you're putting into this supercharger, just compounded in size. So let's just pretend that this is only like a 2.3 liter single small supercharger, right? Real low profile, whatever, 700-800 horsepower special, right? Well, when you compound big volume and the ability to have big volume and pressure into that little blower, it almost triples in size. I mean, there's math to it, right? And all kinds of sizing of the turbo wheels, but we're keeping it simple. Let's just say it's 2 to 1, okay? Now you're pumping 8 liters out of a 2 liter or 15 liters out of a, okay? But there is a restriction that can be in here where this no longer helps you. So it all has to be matched and it starts at the camshaft. That gets crazy technical, but just to explain before we answer the questions, I wanna make sure you guys understand. So we call this a 2 to 1. So let's just say this makes 10 pounds, now it's gonna make 20, but you're not spinning the blower any faster. You're not spinning the turbos any more than 60 to 75% of their max, which keeps this temperature cool before it goes into this temperature that's cool. So nothing is really working that hard. And I'm gonna remind you, when you hear my boat driving, you see that it's despooling as I'm going by at moderate speeds. It's not working so hard, okay? Now, the power output is, and the force on all the parts is, but this system is being efficient because it's going in a smooth circle and it's all matched based on math. Okay, so what happens in this setup is there's an electronic valve here that'll bypass. So if you're driving and you only need 5 pounds of boost, all you need is the supercharger and the vacuum effect for the efficiency. You wouldn't believe the fuel economy that this motor in my boat and the other two that we've done, you wouldn't believe the fuel economy. I mean, it's so efficient because of volumetric efficiency and the way this motor works, right? Again, you have to know what the best and least amount of drag is on the supercharger system that you choose and match the AR on the turbos, which is the basically your ratios and pressures and sizes and wheels, and you have to match it, right? It's not just you pull it off the shelf and do it. But so you guys understand, so an engine, a vacuum, a pressure one, and then a positive displacement PSI differential. So say this is plus 8 pounds, it adds to the blower without really helping it too much. Think about, I don't know if you guys ever looked into or read about pro chargers. You know, a lot of people used to buy the ATI pro chargers, right? And they would put these giant 1200 carburetors on them, right? Well, it would never run that great because
it had no bottom end. It didn't really like it because when you blow through a 1200 CFM carburetor, it's damn near 2000 CFM of pressure. So once they would call me and I would tell them, look, put a 750 on it and it'll run good. They would tell me, this guy doesn't know what he's doing. He's crazy. And then they'd go do it and be like, uh-oh, something's crazy. It like picked up all kinds of drivability and power. And, you know, you got to read about how boost works in a pressure state. It's interesting. I mean, we can go on for hours, right? But I wanted to break this down in such a way where you can understand it. Now, I'm going to go into a couple more things, and then we'll open up to some questions.
So again, your stage one, your pressure differential, let's just say your turbos are running at plus 8 over this 10 pounds. So this becomes a net pressure, which is our stage three, which is your net pressure in the engine. And then this is the pressure state inside above pre-intercooler. So the goal is cool inlet temperature, vacuum system here. Engine not having to do too many RPMs to get going and over spooling and the thing drives like this blue line all the way. And then what happens is, I'm going to draw it for you so you can see it. On a compound, it drives like this. It follows the blue line and just keeps going. It never stops because if the engine demands more air, all of a sudden this supercharger is no longer a restriction because it's making it so efficient. Now, if you mismatch this, it could become a restriction, and then all of a sudden you can't blow through the blower, and then you have a negative impact. So you got to kind of match it properly to work so you can have, you know, a good setup. But again, that's how that works in a nutshell. The other thing is, if you look here, if you run your supercharger at 1-to-1 ratio, your air inlet temperature is always good and cool. You hear a lot of the old school builders, you know, old blower setups, 1-to-1, you know, 7-8 pounds of boost, they last forever. When you go to 15% on a small 6 or 8 71 blower, the efficiency goes way down. So you'll pick up some power, but you're also taking a lot away from that crankshaft. Maybe 200 horsepower to get it. So your net power result is less, yet your boost is higher, which makes for a less reliable setup, right? So you got to make sure you understand the basics there, right? So what we try to do on most of the compounds is go, say, 12 pounds on the blower and another 10 to 15 on the turbo, netting through it. So in other words, you might have 20 feeding it and then the supercharger takes it for what it is. And obviously you have to test to balance it and get it all set up. But the goal is to have this drivability with zero lag, okay? Now,
with all that said, I want to tell you that on our dyno, we dyno engines, a lot of guys dyno engines, and you see the pulls and you see all kinds of different things, long pulls, short pulls, whatever. What's really hard to do on a dyno is measure acceleration, okay? You could do it on an eddy current dyno, and for those of you that don't know what it is, it's in a big giant eddy current motor. It's usually it's like 700 and something volts. You know, you have to have like literally the whole power grid into your shop, and it will stop a 2,000 or 3,000 horsepower motor basically instantly. Well, we don't have that here, obviously. We have pretty good stuff, but we don't have that. We have some ability to test acceleration, but a lot of people ask, and this is like literally like 7 questions came in, like what is it? Why do you need it? How does it work? What's the most benefit? Well, being able to adjust your power levels by bypassing turbo, you know, this, that, and the other, and having a linear power curve, it's just such a good driving boat. It's tame and quiet like a turbo motor, because in a sense it is. So the idle's smooth, never sounds too choppy. They sound very, very docile. Yet you can hide and sneak a giant cam in there and it just tones it down. The ultimate sleeper, right? The other thing is that when you compound, right, it depends on the fuel that you're running. When you do all this and you change to alcohol, all of a sudden, like, you really need a big pulley if you're only supercharged to get all that air and alcohol in there.
So with this, just electronically closing the door right here, right, on each side, you just electronically control it from the ECU. All of a sudden, now these turbos are really putting the air into here. And if you have alcohol in it, then the molecules and all that can get down into this engine. On a supercharged engine, you got to stop, change the pulley, and go. And as you do it, you'll get more power. But the problem is your air inlet temperature over here is going to go through the roof usually, right? Because you're trying to ask this thing to go from 8 to 10,000 RPM to make the same type of boost with the different fuel. Again, you can slow the blower down with bypasses that are here. You can slow each turbo down, and you can do a permanent mechanical bypass, which we put on all of ours. If you close the throttle
really fast, all the blow-off valves on the market, they can't keep up with the volume. So we actually do both. We have bleeders that are like a permanent leak, and then we also have the electronic wastegates and the bypasses. But so if you understand that the drivability of this thing is what's critical, and I skipped around a little bit, sorry, but the acceleration on this setup, when you get all this deal matched, is unbelievable. Like, it's crazy, right? Because you have immediate supercharged power and it never peters out. I mean, it literally is vacuuming and it'll keep going and going and going. Even with camshafts that are not designed for, like, say you build one. We tried one with a small turbo cam. I mean, the turbo cams used to be pretty small back in the day, right? We tried one with a small cam that was good for like 6,000 RPM. I mean, we were spinning that thing 7,200 on the dyno. It was a solid cam, but it was small because the amount of air we can get in that motor just kept going, and it's scavenging the
deal right here. It's pulling air out and allowing it to work. So it's one of those deals where if you actually go online
and look at what some of the Mustang guys are doing, there's a lot of guys doing compound supercharging. I'm not the only one. The diesel market's doing it. Small turbo or big turbo into small turbo, which is opposite of what you would think would work, right? You're putting a big turbo into a small restrictive turbo. Well, it's the same thing. You're doubling the size of that turbo and compressing the air in the turbo, which makes the acceleration gnarly. So the deal is that you can take a big, giant, heavy boat and actually get it to get out of its own way with compounding. So the drivability is good. The efficiency you can't beat. It seems like it'd be worse, right? Because you're spinning a blower and turbos, but the supercharger is there. And yes, it has a negative effect on it all around efficiency. But when you have a vacuum in the motor, out in the exhaust side of things, pulling the air out, it's amazing how it works. So hopefully you guys have an idea on how this all works in basic terms. So what I'd like to do now is I'm going to put the phone in my little holder here, and I'd like to go over some of the questions that were written in, and then we can go over any questions you guys have, and if you need me to explain other things, I'd be happy to. And hopefully, I'm glad you guys actually, we had a couple folks ask for us to come back on and explain it a little better, so I'm always game for doing any of that and trying to educate folks, and that way we all have a better time with boating. So let's see what I had for questions. I got a little here. I see that there's a question about exhaust. So the exhaust pressure is never negative pressure in the exhaust. There's always exhaust pressure, right? But what it's doing is, in regular terms, it's sucking the exhaust gases out of the motor. It's vacuuming. It's pushing, but I want you to think of it as it's pulling it out of the engine, because what happens is the compressor, it's basically how a turbo, once the turbo gets out of lag, it's pulling, right? It's pulling and pushing. It's doing basically a circle of airflow. So that's what I mean by that, if you guys don't quite understand it. It does get technical, but exhaust gases always has pressure. So when I say vacuum, it's not really a vacuum like in your carburetor, but it works as a more efficient exhaust system. Let's look at it that way, okay? The engine itself is not pulling a vacuum in the intake unless you're idling. And most of the compound setups that we do, they'll run They'll run about 700 horsepower before they go into pressure state, 650, 700 horsepower, and you know, they work pretty good. I'll answer some of these questions before I go into the ones that were written in. It says here something about the timing. Cam timing just depends on the camshaft. Most of our camshafts are made out of billet, so they're pretty close to zero or plus or minus 2 degrees, but obviously you have to check them each and every time based on where your keyways are machined into both products, the cam and crank, and that makes a difference. Some people ask about timing. It looks like Eric, maybe I see. The timing on these motors depends on the fuel setting. So if your fuel setting is on pump gas, usually it's 32 degrees. But remember, this is another thing that a lot of people forget. When you, this is a big cubic inch engine, right? It's 650 something cubic inches, right? Timing is based on how long that piston dwells at top dead center. So the bigger the stroke, the longer that piston is hanging at top dead center while the connecting rod is doing this and then going back down, right? So there's a lot of science into timing. You know, we'll run 42 degrees on our motors in a lot of places that are, you know, up to 1 pound of boost because we want high vacuum, and it's fine. It doesn't ping, it doesn't detonate. It's true top dead center, you know, marks. You know, a lot of people, they'll put a timing mark on their harmonic balancer. When the piston stops, they just put the mark and that's where zero is. Well, that's not where zero is. Zero is the difference between when that piston stops and then rocks over and goes back down, and it's the difference between the two. You wouldn't believe how many timing marks are way off, and guys are like, I don't know why I keep blowing my motor. It's 32 degrees and it keeps blowing the pistons apart, and then you find out that their timing mark was bought from some swap meet with a bunch of adjustable things, and they just guessed where it's supposed to go. Or some manufacturers of cast timing covers have marks in them that are incorrect. You know, I always like the ones that come with no marks, so you can trust that your engine builder puts the marks in them. That way you know what's going on. So anyway, some of the questions here, this was written in by a guy named Andrew. It says here, what RPM range does the compound start to make boost? Like I was explaining, it's immediate. It's right off of idle. So at like 1800 RPM, the thing's making all kinds of torque, 1,000 foot-pounds right off idle or more, depending on which setting you have. And that's because basically you're driving a supercharged motor that's very highly efficient at all those low-end speeds and all the way through the range. So there's really zero lag and you're able to have torque instantly. Now, is that necessary maybe in a boat with second and third gear? Maybe not. Maybe you're the guy that spools it up and, you know, shifts to third and it doesn't really matter to you. In my boat, I never use second gear unless I'm just driving around slow, skiing or whatever. I start in basically third gear or overdrive. So it works really good. It says, can you explain the transition from blower to turbo boost? So the supercharger is basically always positively putting out pressure, just like on any supercharged engine. But what happens is the transition you don't necessarily feel, because what's happening is as the supercharger is, say, let's call it dying off, even though it doesn't really die off, the turbos are feeding it. So like you've heard of a ram air on like a car where you put like a little scoop underneath the bumper of your car, that pulls air in. And when you're going, say, 100 miles an hour, it's like forcing air into your engine, right? Makes it run a little better, right? And if you have a supercharger, it makes it run even better. So, you know, it's one of those things where it's it helps a lot in different ways throughout the transition based on the tune. But basically, it's always working in synchrony together throughout the range you create for your application. So for example, my boat's set up one way, but like the 24-foot boat that we built is set up for more luxury cruising with a lot of power. So it may just be feel like it's linear all the way through, and maybe it's set up to where the guy's not gonna wrap the throttle and blow the transmission in 10 pieces. So it just depends on the setup and how that transition comes into play. But the blower is the, I call the blower, the supercharger is the boss, and the turbos are the secondary helpers to it in most cases with compounding. And what it does too is it stimulates the big volume on the whole setup. One more question was written in by another gentleman. It says, how does the Whipple intercooler work and compare to a traditional twin turbo cooler in regards to overall reliability and cooling? And okay, so well, basically, when you have this setup, you can actually have a less efficient supercharger. I'm sorry, a less efficient intercooler because the air inlet charges are down because it's not working hard to make the volume and pressure. Again, remember, a lot of people say, well, how much boost does it make? Well, most of my setups will make 40 pounds, but you only use that on alcohol. And remember, these are 5.8 to 1 compression. They're really low compression engines, and they are able to take a lot of volume. So one thing we must understand is the difference between volume and pressure and how they go together in an engine. You have to understand that because 5 pounds of boost here and 5 pounds of boost on that engine is two different worlds volume-wise, right? It's based on a restriction and several other technical things that obviously you could read about that'll take a little bit of time. But when you understand that, it kind of makes sense. Let's see. Okay, so that's some other questions that I got in. So the inlet temperatures are down. We talked about the ability to start out in a higher gear. That's because you have immediate torque, another question. Multiple power settings, I've talked about it several times, but the ability to have 900 horsepower for a valet mode maybe, or maybe you want your valet guy to have 5 horsepower. You can set them to idle, but you can limit your horsepower levels on the fly. There's a 12 position switch. You can pick whatever map you want. Pump gas, race gas, whatever. If you have a flex fuel sensor, it'll automatically blend for you. This technology wasn't around. I didn't even have that in my boat when I built it. I had to do it most recently. So it's really neat. I used to have to start my boat on gas when I was done with alcohol and let it idle for a half an hour while I was flushing the motor, wiping the boat down just to have the fuel change. It was annoying. Now we can blend it and the computer, you can actually at least idle around or come to your dock or maybe just idle or drive slowly to somebody's house or whatever you're doing to just get all that flux capacitor stuff through the engine. So if you look here, let's see what else was written in. Compress blowers like effects are like an engine, but above it, acceleration. Okay, yeah. So I'm gonna repeat myself on the acceleration. Neck snapping. It's crazy and you can't really do it on a dyno. You'll break it. I've broken my dyno 3 times. I've bolted 2 brakes together, I still break it. Because really the drive plate is only so big and, you know, I mean, I don't normally like to do too much acceleration testing on the dyno because obviously it breaks things, right? So you put it in a boat in real life and you can really get an idea of how it works. It's kind of fun. So I saw a question earlier on the drag on the crankshaft. 1 to 1 versus 15%. 1 to 1 versus 15% on a supercharged engine is quite a bit of drag, that the difference in drag, say on the crankshaft. Now I'm being general. Some superchargers, like an old, like regular 671 versus like a screw type Whipple or the Magna chargers or any of the more efficient superchargers, it's different. That's why some of the other superchargers make more power than others. And you know, you'll see a serpent, like my boat has a serpentine belt on it because the two little blowers, they don't drag much because they're very efficient on the crank. And when you force them with turbo volume, they become small blowers that just supersize them to like 2 PSIs. So again, I'm repeating myself, but I want to explain it in several ways to where you can kind of put it together and come up with some decent questions. Let's see. So the graph we talked about. So when you're looking to set up one of these, most people probably would never build it. We never thought we'd build more than mine, but there's now 4 in production right now. There's 1 more that we're doing and 3 others that are out living. So a 4th one is being born and a 5th one. So it's fun to drive. It's fairly expensive, but not out of this world. I mean, How much is a regular turbo motor fuel injected from me or anybody else? They're around 90 to 100 grand, right? When you do a compound setup, they're like 130 to 140, depending on how you set it up. And we're not making any money on that. It's just expensive parts and a ton of man hours. But some people just want to be different, and we're the facilitator for that, right? So until you drive one, you don't understand. It's just like we've been messing with some electric cars, and really until you drive one, you don't understand how they work. You can only just dream about it. So it's impressive on how the technology is changing on all levels. All right, so what other questions? Let's see. All right, so earlier, I think someone was asking about, let's see. I'm trying to go back here. Let me see if I can go back to some of the questions. I see a current question. I picked 650 cubic inches because I thought that was really big when we were doing 632 cubic inches. And now we're at 814 for an endurance type motor with a 5.4 inch. It's a longer engine block now. So mine's just a baby. The new one I'm building is 814 cubic inches, and the turbos and the superchargers are twice the size of what I have. Literally, they're twice the size. So we're hoping to get 4,500 horsepower on alcohol, and we don't know what it's going to do on gas, but we'll let you know. And obviously, we'll put videos out now that we have cameras where we didn't, say, 8 years ago. A lot of people ask how the computer regulates the boost throughout the range, and I had another question that was on this paper about safety systems. Like, how do you keep the engine from overboosting if you do run it up in second gear? Well, if you run it up in second gear on a V drive, or if you have like a big twin engine MTI skater, whatever type boat, and you're all of a sudden the thing breaks loose. I mean, obviously you have a rev limiter, right? So if you're gonna hit the rev limiter and it's gonna do its thing and sit there until you kind of get the load sorted out or the boat comes over and planes, and that'll work really well. The newer technology ECUs have the ability to detect rate of change. So you can actually program that if this engine accelerates from 2 to 6,000 RPM at anything faster than this rate, pull the throttle blade back. And if it's not an electronic throttle, it'll do other things with the timing to try to manipulate the ability to avoid hitting the rev limiter, which is never any good for anything. I mean, if you go to Lake Havasu and you watch any of these new twin engine boats, I won't mention any names because they all do it. When they go to plane the boat and they're a new driver, they're just literally flooring the boat to get it to do anything. And then all of a sudden it sounds like a popcorn machine until the boat comes over and then it loads. Well, that's really not that great for any engine, but if you can smooth that portion of the tune out or make the engine know that here we go and do something in there to smooth it or dampen it, that'd be awesome, right? So that technology's here. They don't all use it, but it's really, really awesome with drive-by-wire throttle bodies, right? Those are the ones that have no cable. The computer manipulates the blade. So where that benefits huge is right there in that situation and around the docks. Because if you put it in gear and the engine wants to stall, usually we just have these tiny little motors that open up a 3/4 inch hole that keep the engine running. Well, that was cool for a stock 502, but that's not cool for a 600 inch motor or even a heavy duty 572. They just don't move enough air fast enough. So what happens on the electronic ones is it just bumps the blades. It's as if someone's tapping that throttle when you shift it in and out of gear. And a lot of the times when you hear a stock Merc engine or ours or some of the other ones that are using electronic blades, even the Ilmor ski boat motors, you'll hear the blade, you'll hear the RPM kind of drastically change, where before you'd hear like a little hissing sound to try to keep the engine idling. And then what happens is if you put it in neutral, it takes a minute for that motor to decay back into its position. So if you do a neutral reverse right away, this thing doesn't know where you're at, or if it does, it can't react quick enough, and then the engine stalls. Then you hit a dock, and then you're mad at the world, and it's everybody's fault. So we try to avoid that with technology. And What's really cool about the compound setup is it's very docile around the dock. Like, you'll literally watch my boat and it just sounds like it does nothing. You know, it's just like a regular turbo motor. And it's even worse because it's muffled, right? And then you look at the other one we did and it's under the hatch. It's really low in the boat. I mean, you lift the hatch and look in, you can't even see it. And then you look down and oh, there it is, real wide and low. Very quiet. So it's kind of a neat setup. But again, you don't need to have all that to make the net power. So call it 1,000, 1,200, whatever you want to go up to. You could do it with one turbo. I mean, the turbos are so big now, you don't need two. You can have one. Interestingly enough, if you look at some of the drag cars, they're using one giant turbo in the front of them. And the way they're getting that lag out of it is, well, they stage at 7,000 RPM, and as soon as they let go of the clutch, it's immediately loaded. So there's a small transition from lag and net power, but it's so minimal because they need traction that they're good with it, right? So every application has its place. So with that being said, you guys have any other questions that we can go over on some of this stuff? I'd love to talk about it a little more if you'd like. We'll happy to do a part 3 on it if need be. If you guys want to write into boostpower.com or Alexi at boostpower.com or boostpowertv at boostpower.com. I see Dave Johnson from River Dave's Place. How you doing? Let's see. Who else is on? I think Jake Coleman's on there. Supposed to go watch that with Brad Schoenwald, Boats and Shows. If you guys watch that podcast, it's kind of cool. I see you got questions. Let's see. I got questions for you, Jake. I got questions for you in about a half hour. The 24 Shiata does not make as much power as mine. It's way more docile. It's smaller. Cubic inch, smaller turbos, smaller internal superchargers, smaller cylinder heads. I think that thing made 1900 on full kill, and I think it's like 1200 on the base setting and 1400 when it's on the race gas. That one only has pump gas, race gas. So that's the way he wanted it. And, you know, we're not expecting that boat to go 300 miles an hour or anything, but, it actually goes really good. I mean, it's well over 100 miles an hour, that boat. And will the owner drive it like that? I mean, he's only driven it a few hours, so we'll see. But there's some more testing. I mean, I can't tell you that it's done. I mean, it drives good and everything, but we want to try to improve certain things. Or you know, like I said, it took me 3 years to get my boat dialed in, and with multiple people that are involved in it here and with Shiata. And, you know, we're about 6 months into this 24, and I would say we're right there. Like, there's nothing left to do, but I always leave that door open because I like to say that there's never a perfect setup. Like, you always are checking. So, like, for example, we data log everything on that boat. We'll drive around at 50 for a day, drive around at 70 for a day, drive around at 30 for a day, do nothing, try to start it in the most ridiculous weather one day, start it and immediately put it into gear and collect the dates and the information from the logs. So I see you, Dave, but it's very faint on my screen. Where's my RDP hat? This boost power one's worn out. So let's see, what does it say? Do I have pressure sensors on all the stages on the exhaust manifold? Only on the dyno. On the dyno, we had TFX cylinder pressure sensors. So we know all about the transitional, you know, pressures throughout the motor. That's how we got it to work. And once we figured that out, we were able to tune around it. But it was very hard in the beginning. It doesn't just go together. When I first built that boat, I dynoed it and I was impressed, but I wasn't sure. I put it in the boat. We drove it around at 70, 80 miles an hour and it was cool. And the first time I rolled into the throttle, the thing basically shut off and went to idle. And I was like, what the heck is that, you know? And what was happening is I didn't realize that I had my overboost limiter set too low and the sensor was in the wrong place where I wanted to. I had it in between on the dyno to protect the motor so it would come on early. And I didn't move it. I forgot to move it back. So I moved it back and then I turned it off and set it to a higher limit. And that was fun. But I could tell you at 100 miles an hour, when a motor shuts off, it ain't no fun in a V-drive. Even in mine, mine handles really good. But you, if you're not paying attention, it will scare the living daylights out of you. So I don't know. I mean, in our Super V race boat, I remember we had an MSD box go out in a turn at 100 and something miles an hour. And we almost went into the spectator fleet because the boat just wouldn't keep turning. It veered off the course. And everybody asked me, what, you don't know how to drive or turn? And my reply was, nope, I don't know how to drive with one engine in a turn when the ignition shut off. So, you know, this is why now we're 8-coil, we're reluctor wheels, we're, you know, no distributors anymore. We try to keep things more reliable and simple. So, anyway, let's see, what else we got? I can't see what you're there. Hi, Lance. You can drive it anytime you want. You and Steve can go play with it. Let's see. I'm trying to go back. All right, well, hopefully you guys got some ideas of, you know, try to break it down. Let me see what other question this is. I can't really open it. Let me try. With these setups, I've seen risers used instead of headers. Okay, so yeah, that's a good question, actually. He has a question about, no, I don't need glasses. I have 20/10 vision. I can see better than most pilots. But anyway, the question was, can you use manifolds versus headers? Absolutely. I mean, manifolds work really good. I mean, if the internals of the manifolds are designed well on regular turbo motors or compound, they work really good. In fact, the 24-foot boat has little Racero low-profile manifolds, and it works awesome and makes it for low profile. Remember, it's not a restriction if it has a vacuum on it. And remember, I'm using the word vacuum in a way to where so you guys can understand kind of how it works, how it's working. It's always got exhaust pressure, but just think of it as a vacuum cleaner, making that engine efficient, right? So the answer is yes. You can go buy regular IMCO manifolds, build an adapter, put a turbo on it. A lot of guys do it and buy the parts from us, and it works really good. So that makes it kind of neat because it becomes affordable for a guy who just wants to do something like that. And a lot of times people want to be able to run a turbocharger that they might have had, and it's not a under the hatch setup. They can run it dry, and you can build a system fairly reasonable. I mean, a couple of guys with those CP boats and little jet boats, they don't have to cover their engines, so they can build a system pretty reasonable. Let's see, does the catalyst and mufflers cost you any horsepower? Yes, actually the catalyst and the mufflers on my boat do cost some horsepower. They change the way the turbos spool. The turbos actually spool earlier, so it works really good. But it does cost power. But see, the beauty of this setup is if something costs you power, you have so much headroom that you just go ahead and just make your adjustment. So you put another pound and a half of boost in it to get back where you were, and it's not even relevant because the way the turbo system works on top of the supercharger doesn't really cost you a whole lot, right? So the technical answer is yes. The net result in your seat of the pants or when you're driving is no. You don't necessarily feel it at all, which is neat, and it's clean. It doesn't stink. You know, I mean, obviously I have a tune in my boat that blows all kinds of like diesel smoke when you have it turned up, but that's kind of more for fun, kind of like some of the diesel guys do. We did it for some shows with the turbo company, but it's all good. Stuff's kind of fun. Do you have PSI sensors on all stages from exhaust manifold to the second stage of boost? The only pressure sensor I have in the living being boat that it is down below the intercooler. And there is one before the throttle body that tells the computer the difference between the two. And they're just map sensors. They're nothing special. One is reading 3 bar and the other is reading 4 bar. So, you know, it's most supercharged engines are single or two bar map sensors, right? So, and normally aspirated is a single bar. So that way you have the range that you need to adjust. But it's kind of neat to be able to have the adjustability and be able to get, you know, those that information set up. So I got a couple more minutes before I go to the Boats and Shows podcast to visit my buddy Brad and Jake. Let's see. Yes, when I was testing the boat on the dyno and all the way until about 12 months into it, I had pressure sensors in between the headers and the cylinder heads. On the dyno, yes, it looked like a ER room at a hospital. We had every sensor there is. It was kind of neat. Eric, let's see, turbo system. You know what? If I thought I could sell a volume of them, I would. We don't make turbo systems per se, like a part number deal, but we sell all the parts and pieces for the guys that can fabricate on their own and finish them. If not, folks send their engines here that they built, and we go ahead and dress them and customize the turbo system and then send it back to them. Or we dyno it, finish it with the EFI wire harness, and send it back to them. So we do it both ways because we like to be able to, we want to be involved with guys. A lot of people have this misnomer that, oh, we're so expensive, because we sell expensive looking and really nice and expensive high dollar things. But the bottom line is our company fortunately has a big volume in parts purchasing. So if you call and get to know me, our pricing is actually able to be better than anybody's because of the volume we move. It's just our choice. If we like you, we give you a good price. If you're good to us, if you're just calling and saying, well, Joe Blow has it for this price, we'd rather not sell it to you. It's okay. It's just our personality. It's nothing else. But we do sell all the parts you need, and we'll be happy to help design any type of system that you want, and would be happy to help publicize it. I mean, we work with a lot of big name other engine companies that are in our business with supercharging, EFI, and we don't mind promoting them. They're using a little bit of our technology and a lot of the good work that they do. Our buddy Aaron's out there from Smith Power in Lake of the Ozarks. They just built Travis Reed some really big supercharged motors with our EFI system on it, remote tuning, and they've had really good luck with it. And we like working with guys that are sharp and know what they're doing all over the globe. So if you guys ever need any of that information or any kind of assistance, we're here for you there too. Let's see. Do you pay me to put motor? I don't understand. Thanks for the support. Okay, gotcha. When's your next EFI class? So our EFI class, we do 4 a year, once a quarter. So let's see, what are we now? Probably, I think it's November, end of November. We also do private ones, and we're trying to figure out a way to do one. This is good news for you guys. If everything works out the way I want it to, we're gonna have free EFI classes on Facebook Live or one of the networks that you'll be able to log into, but they'll be sponsored by one or two companies per event. That way they pay for it, for the advertising, which we support. We will use their EFI product to teach you, and maybe that is a better way. Like, we get about, I don't know, if we do it quarterly, we get up to 20 people, and then we kind of cap it. If we do it, you know, privately, it could be costly, but private lessons are cool because you might have a Pectel EFI, or you might have a EFI technology, or you might have a Autronic system, or one of the systems that no one's familiar with. And we've, you know, I personally have been doing it since I was a kid, so I understand all of them very well. And ones that I haven't used, I learn quickly. So I can teach you at least the basics, and if not, the advanced ways to tune. And but anyway, that's really good news. Hopefully that works out for 2019. We'll be able to offer, you know, at least basic classes, you know, or segments that you guys can refer back to. If you look on our Boost Power Marine YouTube, you can see the some of our basic videos that show the basics of like the AEM Infinity and some of the other ones. So, all right, so we're going to go to Boats and Shows and hang out with Jake and Brad here. Thanks for joining us. There's about 50 to 60 people currently. That's pretty neat. And I'm sure it'll go up to 20,000 like it did last week, which is really neat for us. We enjoy it because people are actually responding. So, and again, we're doing this for you guys to try to explain it in several different levels of understanding any of the stuff we're doing. And if you have any questions and you want to go over something and you're afraid to mention that you're dealing with somebody else, look, we'll help anybody. We don't discriminate against it in any way. So please reach out, Alexi@boostpower.com, boostpower@aol.com, or pretty much any way through the social media, one of the gals will get it to me. Have a great night. And again, if you guys are staying online tonight, go to Boats and Shows and we'll talk to Brad. All right, have a great night and thanks again.